Hello friends, now today we will be discussing about a very important topic, that is asthma. So in asthma we will be discussing about two major concepts. First we will discuss about the drugs for asthma, what are the drugs which we use for the asthma, and the second part we will overall discuss how to manage asthma, management of asthma. Okay, so we will be discussing about the drugs for asthma and management of asthma. So let's start first about the various drugs which are used for the treatment of asthma. Okay, so if you talk about the drug, first we should know what is asthma. Remember, asthma, it is an allergic disease. Asthma is an allergic disease. Allergic disease are also known as hypersensitive disease. So it's a kind of hypersensitivity. Now, which kind of hypersensitivity? You will write type 1 hypersensitivity, which is IgE mediated hypersensitivity. Type 1 hypersensitivity is also known as IgE mediated hypersensitivity. Okay. Now, what happens in any allergic disease? Remember, in any allergic disease, there is an antigen. There is an antigen. Suppose this is an antigen. This antigen, it comes into the body of a patient who is allergic to this antigen. This antigen goes to one antibody. That antibody is IgE. This antigen goes to an antibody IgE. And remember, this IgE, it normally is attached on the surface of a cell. These cells are known as mast cells. This IgE antibody is attached to the surface of a cell known as mast cell. So what happens when this antigen, it comes and bind to this IgE antibody, these mast cells, they become active. These mast cells, they become active and they release various chemical mediators or inflammatory mediators. Various inflammatory mediators. Okay. So there are various inflammatory mediators like histamine. Okay. You will write leukotrienes. Now, which leukotrienes? You must remember LTC4 and LTD4. Okay. So LT stands for leukotrienes, and many interleukins and various interleukins. Various interleukins like interleukin 5, interleukin 4, etc. that we will be discussing shortly. Okay, so these mast cells, they become active and they release these chemical mediators. Okay, now among them, one chemical mediator is very important for us, that is leukotriene. Because against for this leukotriene, we have certain drug. Okay, so how these leukotrienes, they are synthesized? Remember, these leukotrienes, they are synthesized in the mast cell with the help of one enzyme. There is one enzyme which is present in the mast cell that synthesizes this leukotriene, and these leukotrienes are released. That enzyme is known as, which is present in the mast cell, that enzyme is known as LOX enzyme. That enzyme is known as LOX enzyme. LOX enzyme synthesizes leukotriene. The full form of LOX is lipoxygenase. Okay, the full form of LOX enzyme is lipoxygenase. So these leukotrienes, they are synthesized by LOX enzyme inside the mast cell. Now what will happen? So these leukotrienes, they go to the bronchus. They go to an organ known as bronchus. Okay. And on bronchus, there are smooth muscles of bronchus. Suppose these are the muscles of the bronchus. Let's call it as smooth muscles of bronchus. Okay. On these smooth muscles of bronchus, remember, there are receptors of these leukotrienes. There are receptors of these leukotrienes. The receptors of leukotrienes on the smooth muscles of bronchus are known as cis-LT1 receptor. So these receptors are present on the smooth muscles of bronchus. So when these leukotrienes, they go and attach to the cis-LT1 receptors, which are present on bronchial smooth muscle, what it will lead to? It leads to bronchoconstriction. It leads to bronchoconstriction. Okay, and what is asthma? Remember, in asthma, the main symptom a patient has is bronchoconstriction. Okay, so this bronchus will become collapsed, it will constrict, and the person will find very difficult to breathe. Okay, so if you have understood this pathway, let's understand certain drugs for bronchial asthma. Okay, let's understand certain drugs for bronchial asthma. The first drug is, we have developed a drug which will inhibit the interaction of this antigen to this IgE antibody. The drug which will block this antigen so that it could not attach to IgE antibody. The drug is omalizumab. So omalizumab, mab word is coming, so it's a monoclonal antibody against IgE. It blocks IgE. Omalizumab, it blocks IgE, so that this antigen will not able to act on this IgE, so that this mast cell will not become active. Now the second drug we have is, that second drug that acts on mast cells, and they will tell this mast cell that these mast cells that they should not release these chemical mediators. They prevent the activation of mast cell. These drugs are known as mast cell stabilizers. So they prevent the release of chemical mediators or inflammatory mediators from mast cell. Okay, now the third drug which we have made is a LOX inhibitor. The drug which inhibits lipoxygenase enzyme so that these leukotrienes are not synthesized inside the mast cell. The drug name is Zilutron. There is only one drug known as Zilutron. Okay, so this drug Zilutron is a LOX inhibitor, lipoxygenase inhibitor. It inhibits the synthesis of leukotrienes C4 and D4. Okay, then finally, we have a drug which will block this cis-LT1 receptor. We have a drug that will block cis-LT1 receptor, so that these leukotrienes will not able to act on this bronchial smooth muscle, and hence they will not able to carry bronchoconstriction. These drugs are also known as leukotriene receptor, leukotriene receptor blockers. So which receptors they block? They block cis-LT1 receptor. Okay, now remember, till now the drugs which we have written, omalizumab, mast cell stabilizer, let's name it as one, mast cell stabilizer number two, LOX inhibitor three, and leukotriene receptor blocker. Remember, all these drugs are anti-inflammatory drug. Okay, so all these drugs, they inhibit this inflammation which is causing bronchoconstriction. So all these drugs which we have written till now, like omalizumab, muscle stabilizers, LOX inhibitor, leukotriene receptor blocker, they are anti-inflammatory drug. Now we have one anti-inflammatory drug which have all the properties of all above drug. All above properties, that broad spectrum anti-inflammatory drug we have is, that drug is corticosteroids. So can we say that corticosteroid, they have all action? They have all action. So they are broad spectrum anti-inflammatory drug, corticosteroid. So they have all the action. Okay, but we have now a class of a drug which will directly go to the bronchial smooth muscles, which will directly go to these bronchial smooth muscles, and they act as a bronchodilator. They act as a bronchodilator. Okay, they act as a bronchodilator. Remember, all these drugs which we have written, like omalizumab, muscle stabilizers, LOX inhibitor, leukotriene receptor blocker, and these, a combination of all these drugs. Remember, all these drugs are anti-inflammatory drug, but they are not bronchodilator. So they can decrease inflammation which is occurring in this hypersensitivity, but they are not bronchodilator. So we have made a class of a drug which will directly go to this bronchial smooth muscle, and they directly causes bronchodilation. Okay, so among bronchodilators we have three classes of drug. On this bronchial smooth muscle, suppose this is a bronchial smooth muscle, we have various receptors. The first receptor which is present on bronchial smooth muscle is beta 2 receptor. It is a sympathetic nervous system receptor. Okay, and remember, sympathetic nervous system receptor beta 2, it causes bronchodilation. Okay, so beta 2, when we stimulate beta 2, it causes bronchodilation. Okay, so the first bronchodilator we have is beta 2 agonist. So they are sympathetic drug. They are sympathomimetic drugs. Okay, now we have one more receptor on this bronchial smooth muscle, that is M3 receptor. Now remember, M3 stands for muscarinic receptor, and muscarinic receptor is a parasympathetic receptor. Not sympathetic, rather parasympathetic. And remember, when we stimulate muscarinic receptor, it causes bronchoconstriction. Okay, so sympathetic nervous system causes bronchodilation. We use beta 2 agonist, similar drug. So what kind of a drug would you like to use in case of parasympathetic nervous system? We use a drug which will block this M3 receptors, because M3 receptor or muscarinic receptor, they cause bronchoconstriction. So the second class of a drug we have is anti-muscarinics. Anti-muscarinic drug. So these drugs, they are parasympatholytic drug. That means they are decreasing parasympathetic activity. Sympathomimetic, they are increasing parasympathetic activity. Okay, now the third class of a drug is that drug, this drug will not go to the receptor beta 2 or M3. It will not go to the receptor on the surface of the cell. Remember, this class of a drug will go inside the bronchial smooth muscle. And it will bring certain changes, and these smooth muscles, they will become relaxed, and bronchodilation will occur. That drug with that will go inside the cell and act, that class of a drug is methylxanthines. Okay, and among them we will have a drug known as theophylline. So among bronchodilators we have three classes of drug, that is beta 2 agonist, antimuscarinics, and methylxanthines. So these are the drugs. Now let's write their names, and after writing these names, we have discussed certain classes like muscle stabilizers, leukotriene antagonist, corticosteroid, bronchodilators. Apart from this, we have certain new drugs. So let's discuss first about new drugs, and then we will come back to these all drugs which we have discussed till now. Okay, so let's discuss first certain new drugs in asthma. Okay, So let's discuss about first new drugs in asthma. The first drug you will write is magnesium sulfate. Remember, magnesium is also a bronchodilator. Why? Because magnesium, it inhibits calcium inside our body, and calcium is needed for muscle contraction. Calcium causes muscle contraction, so it's inhibit calcium, hence there will be bronchodilation. Remember, magnesium sulfate is only used in acute severe asthma, that we will discuss in management of asthma. Acute severe asthma, another name of acute severe asthma, it is also known as status asthmaticus. Acute severe asthma is also known as status asthmaticus, but nowadays we use the term acute severe asthma. We don't use the term status asthmaticus. Okay, now the second bronchodilator you will write is chromacallim. Chromacallim, what is chromacallim? Chromacallim is a potassium channel opener. Potassium channel opener. Remember, inside the muscle cell there is potassium, and if this potassium moves outside because of opening of channel, the muscle become hyperpolarized, and if a muscle becomes hyperpolarized, the muscle relaxes. Okay, but remember, this drug is not approved yet, not approved yet, but very soon this drug will be approved. Okay, now let's move further. We will write a make a heading, monoclonal antibodies in asthma. Monoclonal antibodies in asthma. Okay, so this is a very new class of drug, and it's a very hot topic nowadays. Okay, so the first monoclonal antibody which we have already discussed is omalizumab. That is omalizumab. Okay, now omalizumab, it blocks, it's a monoclonal antibody which is against IgE. It blocks IgE. Okay, and how it is given? Remember, all monoclonal antibodies, they are given by injections. All monoclonal antibodies are given by injection. It is given by subcutaneous injection. It is given by subcutaneous injection after every 2 to 4 weeks. After every 2 to 4 weeks, and where it is used, you will write omalizumab is a drug of choice for corticosteroid resistant asthma. So that management we will discuss shortly. Corticosteroid resistant asthma. Okay, recently it has been also approved for one more type 1 hypersensitive disease, just like asthma, that is chronic idiopathic urticaria. Chronic idiopathic urticaria. Urticaria means skin lesions. Okay, which is a type 1 hypersensitivity. Now this is omalizumab, which we have already discussed. Now we already know, if you come back to that same diagram, we have already discussed that these mast cell, they release various interleukins, like interleukin 5, interleukin 4, etc., many interleukin. So we block this interleukin. So let's discuss about certain newer monoclonal antibodies in asthma. Newer monoclonal antibodies in asthma. Okay, so let's write their name. The first drug you will write is mepolizumab. Mepolizumab. This mepolizumab, it blocks, you will write, this mepolizumab, it blocks interleukin 5. Mepolizumab, it blocks interleukin 5. Where it is used? Sir, it is used in asthma, that we know. Recently it has been approved for a similar condition known as Churg-Strauss syndrome. Churg-Strauss syndrome. Okay, now let's discuss one more drug, a similar drug, restlizumab. Restlizumab is also against interleukin 5, but right now it is only approved for asthma. Restlizumab is only approved for asthma. Okay, third drug you will write is बेनरालिजुमैब, बेनरालिजुमैब ब्लॉक्स इंटरल्यूकिन 5 रिसेप्टर, इट ब्लॉक्स इंटरल्यूकिन 5 रिसेप्टर, वाइल मेपोलिजुमैब एंड रेस्टलिजुमैब दे विल डायरेक्टली अटैच टू इंटरल्यूकिन 5 एंड प्रिवेंट्स इट एक्शन. बेनरालिजुमैब विल ब्लॉक द रिसेप्टर ऑफ इंटरल्यूकिन 5 वेयर इट इज यूज्ड अगेन एस्थमा. सो दे ऑल आर यूज्ड इन एस्थमा. ए फॉर एस्थमा वी विल राइट. ओके, नाउ टिल दिस these four monoclonal antibodies are expected that you must remember. Okay, these four monoclonal antibodies are expected from you and you must remember these four monoclonal antibody. But we will discuss about all the monoclonal antibody which are till now which are used in asthma, but most of them are not approved. So they are not approved, which we will be writing now, but they are used in asthma, they are in clinical trials. So let's see the other monoclonal antibody you will write. So we will write with a blue color pen, and this is not expected from you, but you should make a list. Inokizumab, inokizumab, it blocks interleukin 9. Okay, then you will write calixemab. Calix, so inoki 9 is coming. 9 means no. You can remember no means 9. Okay, no means 9. Okay, calixemab you can write CD4. CD4, so C and K which have similar pronunciation. Okay, then you will write enrukizumab. Enrukizumab and lebri kixizumab. Lebri kixizumab, these both monoclonal antibody, they block interleukin 13. They block interleukin 13. Then you will write lumiliximab. Lumiliximab, it blocks CD23. And lastly you will write the last monoclonal antibody is ligelizumab. Ligelizumab, it blocks IgG, it blocks immunoglobulin epsilon chain C. It blocks immunoglobulin epsilon chain C. So these monoclonal antibodies are not expected from you, because till now nobody have asked about these monoclonal antibodies, but you must remember that these are the certain newer monoclonal antibody, very soon they will be approved. So what is expected from you? What is expected? These four monoclonal antibodies are expected from you, that you must remember their name. Okay, that is omalizumab, mepolizumab, restlizumab and benralizumab. Okay, so try to remember these four names. Okay, so these are the newer monoclonal antibodies in asthma. Okay, so now let's come to the conventional drug which we have already discussed. So let's classify these drugs. So can we classify all these drugs as either bronchodilators or anti-inflammatory? Okay, so these drugs are classified as bronchodilators or anti-inflammatory drug. So let's classify these drugs as in asthma as bronchodilator so anti-asthma drugs they can be classified as either bronchodilators or anti-inflammatory drug. Okay, simply, so bronchodilators we have discussed, there are three bronchodilators, that is beta 2 agonist. So among beta 2 agonists you can write one drug, that is salbutamol and various congeners, various similar drugs like salbutamol. Okay, then you can write antimuscarinics. Among antimuscarinic, the first drug which we made was ipratropium, And now we have made many other drug, you will write and congeners. And congeners. And lastly, we will write methylxanthines. And among methylxanthine, you will write the main drug is theophylline, which is found in tea, which we drink, theophylline and congener. Okay. Now remember, among these three drugs, this theophylline, it is a bronchodilator, we know, but theophylline is also an anti-inflammatory drug. It is also an anti-inflammatory drug. So it has dual role. Okay. So it is also an anti-inflammatory. Okay. So let's talk about now anti-inflammatory drugs. The major anti-inflammatory drug is, remember, corticosteroids. Is corticosteroids. Okay. So they are the most effective, because they have all action, most effective anti-inflammatory drug. Okay. Most effective. Then we have leukotriene, receptor antagonist. Okay. So these drugs, they generally end with the word leukast. So you can write one drug, montelukast. And all other drugs will be ending with the word leukast only. Okay, etc. Then you will write LOX inhibitor. The only drug is Zilutone. But remember, this Zilutone is now not used. So we will not be discussing about this drug any further, because this Zilutone is highly hepatotoxic drug. So it is not used in India. In many countries, it has been banned, including India. And because of this reason, it is now not used. Okay. So let's move further. So we will not discuss about this drug, but at least you must remember the name, lipoxygenase inhibitor. Okay. Now let's move further. Then we have mast cell stabilizers. Mast cell stabilizers. There are three mast cell stabilizers. You will write nidocromil, chromoglycate, and ketotifen. So these are the three mast cell stabilizers. Okay. Now the point is, among all of them, the most effective anti-inflammatory drug we have is corticosteroid. But remember, these corticosteroids, they are not bronchodilators. They are not bronchodilators. Okay. So now a question arises. How do we manage asthma? So let's discuss first about management of asthma, and then we will be discussing about the properties of all these individual drugs which are used in asthma. Okay. So let's discuss about first management of asthma. Okay. So let's discuss about first management of asthma. Okay. Now remember one point, sir. If a patient comes to you with acute attack of asthma, if a patient comes to you with acute attack of bronchoconstriction or acute attack of asthma, can you tell me which drug would you like to use, a bronchodilator or an anti-inflammatory? If a patient comes to you with acute attack of asthma, which drug would you like to use? Remember, if a patient comes to you with acute attack of asthma, we have only one drug, that is salbutamol. Okay. So the drug of choice for acute attack of asthma will be beta 2 agonist, that is salbutamol. Okay. But tell me, if a patient is having recurrent asthma, again and again a patient is having recurrent attack of asthma, so can you tell me you have to give a drug for prevention of asthma? You have to give one drug for prevention of asthma. So for prevention of asthma, remember, we give anti-inflammatory drug. For prevention of asthma, we give anti-inflammatory drug. Can you tell me which anti-inflammatory drug would you like to use for prevention of asthma, so that this bronchoconstriction should not occur? Can we say we must use the most effective anti-inflammatory drug, that is corticosteroid? So how we give this corticosteroid in our patient, you will write the drug of choice for Prevention of asthma is inhalational corticosteroids. Okay, just keep these two points in your mind. By keeping these two things in our mind, that for acute attack of asthma we give a bronchodilator, beta 2 agonist salbutamol, and for prevention of asthma we use the best anti-inflammatory drug corticosteroid through inhalational route. Okay, by keeping this thing in mind, now let's see what is the management of asthma. Okay, for how we treat asthma. Okay, so for the treatment of asthma, first we should know what are the different types of asthma we know. Okay, what are the different types of asthma we have. Okay, so types of asthma, remember, asthma can be divided into episodic asthma. That means it occurs very occasionally. And the second we have is chronic asthma, which is also known as persistent asthma. Which is also known as persistent asthma. That means it occurs very frequently. Now, what is the difference between episodic and persistent asthma? Remember, in episodic asthma, we need an antigen. So this antigen will go to the body. This antigen is also known as allergen. Okay, so there is requirement of allergen, and this allergen will go and it will produce bronchoconstriction. It will produce bronchoconstriction. Okay, now the point is, sir, here in episodic asthma, the attack of this asthma is very occasional. Hence, when the patient is not having asthma, let's say during inter-attack period, the patient is absolutely normal. When the patient is not having an attack of asthma, then the patient is absolutely normal. Okay? Now, what about chronic or persistent asthma? Remember, in chronic and persistent asthma, it can occur with an allergen or it can occur without an allergen also. Okay, that means in this case, the bronchoconstriction may occur without antigen. Sir, why? Because, sir, in cases of chronic or persistent asthma, the bronchus of that patient becomes hyperactive. The bronchus becomes hyperactive. There is bronchial hypertrophy. There is bronchial hypertrophy, which is also known as bronchial remodeling. Okay, so the bronchus has changed now. Because of this reason, even without antigen, the bronchus frequently and every time it undergoes bronchoconstriction. Because of this reason, remember, during inter-attack period, when the patient is not having acute attack of asthma, remember, the patient is not normal. Okay, the patient is not normal. The patient has certain symptoms. The patient is not able to carry its lifestyle properly. So we will discuss about. So let's discuss first about the management of episodic asthma. Okay. So can we say, let's discuss this episodic asthma. We discuss divide this episodic asthma into two. Okay, so this episodic asthma is first classified as mild episodic asthma. Mild episodic asthma. Second, you can write seasonal asthma, which occurs due to occurrence of a particular season, like spring, autumn, when there are pollen grains. Okay, also known as seasonal asthma, which occurs with the forthcoming of a particular season. You can also write exercise induced asthma. Exercise induced asthma. Okay, so all these conditions are mild episodic asthma. Now, how do we manage it? So suppose the patient may come to you in two scenario. The patient may come to you with acute attack of asthma. Okay, the patient will come to you with acute attack of asthma. Can you tell me what is the drug of choice for acute attack of asthma? The only drug of choice for acute attack of asthma we have is salbutamol. You will write the group of this salbutamol is short acting beta 2 agonist. Short acting beta 2 agonist. And even in this case, remember the drug of choice for any cause of acute attack of asthma is same, salbutamol. Okay, so salbutamol in short form we will call it as SABA. SABA stands for short acting beta 2 agonist. Short acting beta 2 agonist. Okay, now my second question is, what do you do for prevention of this asthma? Prevention of this asthma. Remember, in this case, the patient when is not having any acute attack of asthma, the patient is absolutely normal in episodic asthma. So there is no treatment required. No treatment required for prevention. Okay. And what about seasonal? Can we say if a person is going to have a particular season, suppose there is a season one month after there is spring season and there is various pollen grains. We know that in a particular season, a person will have an acute attack of asthma. So before the onset of season or before starting an exercise, we start the patient on inhalational corticosteroid. We start the patient on inhalational corticosteroid. Because corticosteroids are anti-inflammatory drug, we have discussed that they are used for prevention of asthma. So prevention, we only give in seasonal or exercise induced asthma. So we will write inhalational corticosteroid as ICS. Okay, so short acting beta 2 agonist as SABA and ICS. Please use this short form. Okay, so the drug of choice for seasonal or exercise induced asthma is, prevention is inhalational corticosteroid, but you can, so it is a DOC. DOC is drug of choice, but you can also use mast cell stabilizers. You can also use mast cell stabilizers. Okay, you can also use mast cell stabilizers, but remember the drug of choice is inhalational corticosteroid. So which mast cell stabilizers, which we have already written, chromoglycate, nidocromil, etc., which we will discuss again. Okay, so remember these drugs, mast cell stabilizer, they are just for prevention. Okay, they are not used for acute attack of asthma. Can you tell me why these drugs, corticosteroid and mast cell stabilizer, they are not used for acute attack? Because they are not bronchodilators. They are not bronchodilators. So when a person is having acute attack of bronchoconstriction or acute attack of asthma, we give short acting beta 2 agonist. So this is the treatment of episodic asthma. Okay, now just write one additional point, said that these drugs, mast cell stabilizers or inhalational corticosteroid, they are started 1 month before the onset of season. They are started 1 month before the onset of season. Okay, and they are useless if the patient have acute attack of asthma. They are useless if the patient has acute attack of asthma, and you know why? Because they are not bronchodilator. So these drugs must be started before 1 month before the onset of season. Okay, so they are preventive drug. Now let's discuss about, so this is the treatment of episodic asthma. Okay, so in episodic asthma, we know that antigen will come when season with exercise. Okay, in exercise the antigen is mainly cold air or the stress, and in inter attack period the patient is absolutely normal. Okay, so acute attack, SABA drug of choice. To prevent, we only give prevention in seasonal and exercise induced asthma. The drug of choice is inhalational corticosteroids. Okay, now let's come to the treatment of chronic or persistent asthma. Okay, chronic or persistent asthma. Now the point is, chronic or persistent asthma, let's see the treatment. Okay, now chronic or persistent asthma, remember the patient may come to you with an acute attack of asthma. The patient will come to you with acute attack of asthma. you will give a drug, and we know that the patient has a recurrent attack because in the bronchus is now hyperactive. A patient has various recurrent attack, occasional, very recurrent attack in persistent asthma. That is why it is known as persistent asthma. Because of this reason, we give a drug for maintenance or prevention of asthma. We give a drug for maintenance or prevention of asthma. Okay? Prevention of asthma. Now, can you tell me the drug of choice for acute attack? Again, the drug of choice for acute attack of asthma is short-acting beta-2 agonist. Short-acting beta-2 agonist, that is SABA. So, you know one drug, that is salbutamol. Salbutamol. Okay? Okay? Salbutamol. And the drug of choice for maintenance is again inhalational corticosteroids. Inhalational corticosteroids. Okay? But how we will give inhalational corticosteroid, that we will discuss shortly. Okay? How we will give. Now the point is, if the patient is having chronic or persistent asthma, for acute attack we always give short acting beta 2 agonist. Always. This is the drug of choice. A person will inhale salbutamol, and for maintenance this. Now there are problems. Sometimes what happens, this acute attack is not controlled. Despite using this salbutamol, if it is not controlled by this salbutamol, then this asthma, if this acute attack of asthma is not controlled by this salbutamol, then this asthma is also known as status asthmaticus. Then this asthma is known as status asthmaticus, which is also known as acute severe asthma. Okay? Then it is known as acute severe asthma. So what is the definition of status asthmaticus? Status asthmaticus means an acute attack of asthma. You will write the definition of status asthmaticus. Acute attack of asthma that is not controlled by usual dose of short acting beta 2 agonist, that is SABA. Okay, so this is the definition of acute severe asthma or status asthmaticus. Now remember, this status asthmaticus is an emergency, and shortly we will see the treatment of status asthmaticus shortly. Okay, so what is status asthmaticus? If this acute attack is not controlled by SABA, it is known as status asthmaticus. Okay, so we will see the treatment of status asthmaticus shortly. Now let's see how we will give corticosteroids for maintenance of this asthma. Now remember, sir, we will give corticosteroid according to severity of symptoms. According to severity of symptoms, a patient is telling you. Okay, if the patient, according to the severity of symptoms, we classify this chronic or persistent asthma into three types. We classify chronic or persistent asthma into three types according to the symptoms. The first is known as mild chronic asthma. Mild chronic or mild persistent asthma. Okay, now in mild or persistent asthma, a person has occasional attacks. Okay, then we have moderate chronic asthma or moderate persistent asthma. Okay, here the patient has very frequent attacks. Okay, and then we write severe asthma. You'll write severe asthma. Here the patient has continuous attack. Okay, so how we classify them into occasional, frequent or continuous attack? Let's see. Sir, we will ask the history of the patient. We will ask the patient two things in our history. The first thing we will ask in our patient is, sir, how many attacks per day you have of bronchoconstriction? Okay, how many attacks do you have per day of bronchoconstriction? In mild, a patient will say, sir, I have at least one attack per day. At least one attack per day. In moderate, the patient will say, I have more than one attack per day. And in severe asthma, patient says, I have continuous attack. I am never free without any attack of bronchodilation, asthma. I always have continuous bronchoconstriction. Okay. Second point we will write, when you are not having attack during inter-attack period, how do you feel? During inter-attack period, how do you feel? The patient says that I am subnormal. I am not able to carry out my activity normally. In moderate, the patient will tell you that I have severe limitation of activity. Severe limitation of activity. And in severe asthma, the patient will say that I am bedridden, incapacitated. Incapacitated. Okay? So this is the importance of history. So how do we treat? Okay, so how we will maintain or prevent this asthma? Remember, the drug of choice is inhalational corticosteroid. We will write the short form, inhalational corticosteroid. Okay, here you will write, in mild asthma we give in low dose. We give in low dose. Okay, low dose. Sir, how much dose? Just you will write, the dose is 100 to 500 microgram per day. Okay, low dose. Okay, and if the patient is well controlled, if the patient is well controlled on this dose, remember, we change, we decrease the dose of inhalational corticosteroid by replacing with mast cell stabilizers, because corticosteroids in long terms, they are not very good drugs. They cause various side effects. Okay, if the patient is well controlled, replace with mast cell stabilizer. But if the patient is not controlled by this usual dose, then we put the patient on moderate one. Okay, hence we will increase the dose, we will give high dose of inhalational corticosteroid. ICS stand for inhalational corticosteroid. So this dose is generally around 500 to 800 microgram per day. Okay. Now the point is, as we know, the patient is having very frequent attack. Hence, with this ICS, inhalational corticosteroid, we will add a drug that is long-acting beta 2 agonist. Okay, so corticosteroid, they will prevent the attack, and we will use a long-acting beta 2 agonist. It will maintain bronchodilation for long duration of time because the patient has very frequent bronchoconstriction. So long-acting beta 2 agonist, they are also known as LABA. So they are given for prevention. Remember, short acting are given for treatment. So this is the treatment of moderate asthma. So in moderate asthma, we will increase the dose of inhalational corticosteroid and we will add LABA. Okay. Now, if the patient is well controlled, remember, we will replace this LABA. We replace this LABA with leukotriene antagonist. We replace this LABA with leukotriene antagonist because this LABA on long term, it is highly cardiotoxic, that we will discuss shortly, because it causes severe arrhythmias. Because of this reason, they causes cardiotoxicity, we slowly and slowly replace this long-acting beta-2 agonist with this. But if the patient is not controlled, we put the patient on third one. Okay, so in third one, we will give the highest dose. We will give the highest dose of inhalational corticosteroid. We will give the highest dose of inhalational corticosteroid, that is around 800 to 2000 microgram per day. Okay, plus we will give LABA. We will continue that. Now the patient, remember one point, in these two condition, you know that the patient is having very frequent attacks, very continuous attack. Suppose the patient is having acute attack of asthma during sleeping. A patient is having nocturnal asthma. During sleep, a patient is having nocturnal asthma. So these LABA and inhalational corticosteroid, they are taken by inhalational route. So if a patient has frequent attack during sleep, then we will give a drug, we will add a drug, the drug of choice for nocturnal asthma, you will write an oral tablet of theophylline. Oral tablet of theophylline, which is taken before bedtime. Okay? So this is how we will manage a case of chronic persistent asthma. So what you are seeing here, that we are increasing the dose of inhalational corticosteroid as we are going from mild to moderate to severe. This therapy, this mode that we are increasing the dose of inhalational corticosteroid, this therapy is also known as step up therapy. Step up means we are increasing the dose of inhalational corticosteroid as the patient is having more symptoms. Okay, now the point is, sir, even if the asthma is not controlled yet, if still it is not controlled by maximum dose or the highest dose of inhalational corticosteroid, this asthma is also known as refractory asthma. Now, what is the definition of refractory asthma? Refractory asthma means asthma which is not controlled by the maximum dose of inhalational corticosteroid. So what you will do now? So in refractory asthma, remember, the drug of choice, you will start oral, not inhalational, you will start oral corticosteroids. Okay, so in refractory asthma, that is not controlled by maximum dose of inhalational corticosteroid, this is known as refractory asthma. In refractory asthma, now instead of inhalational route, you will give oral corticosteroid, and that oral corticosteroid is prednisolone. What is the dose? You will write 30 to 40 milligram per day. Okay, so if this asthma is not controlled by maximum inhalational dose of inhalational corticosteroid, is known as refractory asthma. Now start oral corticosteroid. Sir, even if the asthma is not controlled, even by oral as well as inhalational corticosteroid, this asthma is also known as corticosteroid resistant asthma. So what is the definition of corticosteroid resistant asthma? Not controlled by inhalational and oral corticosteroid. Okay, so now what we will do here, the drug of choice is omalizumab. Okay, so omalizumab was a monoclonal antibody that blocks IgE. Okay, so this is the role of omalizumab. So omalizumab is the drug of choice for corticosteroid resistant asthma. Okay, corticosteroid resistant asthma. So this is how we manage chronic persistent asthma. So let's recapitulate. It's very simple now. So we will take the history. How we will give prevention of asthma? We will take the history of the patient, whether the patient is having mild symptoms, moderate symptom or severe. The drug of choice for prevention of asthma is always inhalational corticosteroid, and we will keep on increasing the dose. This therapy is known as step-up therapy. So in mild cases, if it is well controlled, replace this inhalational corticosteroid with mast cell stabilizers. Okay, but if it is not controlled, then increase the dose and add LABA. Increase the dose and add LABA. If it is well controlled, replace this LABA with leukotriene antagonist because they are cardiotoxic. Okay, if it is still not controlled, continue with ICS in highest possible dose, add LABA. And if the patient has frequent night awakening because of nocturnal asthma, add theophylline. Okay, add theophylline. If it is still not controlled with inhalational corticosteroid at maximum dose, it is known as refractory asthma, start oral corticosteroid, that is prednisolone, 30 to 40 milligram per day. If it is still not controlled, it is known as corticosteroid resistant asthma. Here you will give omalizumab. Okay, so this is how you will prevent or maintain chronic persistent asthma. Okay, so this is how we will maintain or give maintenance or prevention of asthma. Okay, now let's talk about the acute one, which we have already discussed. We have discussed about that for acute attack we use which drug? Salbutamol, short acting beta 2 agonist. Okay, if it is not controlled, it is known as status asthmaticus or acute severe asthma. So let's see the management of acute severe asthma. Okay, so let's see the management of status asthmaticus. Or you will write acute severe asthma. Okay, so what is the definition of status asthmaticus? An acute attack of asthma not controlled by usual dose of short acting beta 2 agonist. Usual dose, okay. The acute attack not controlled by usual dose of SABA. So let's see what is the treatment of status asthmaticus. Okay, so if it is not controlled by usual dose of SABA, then we will give the treatment. The first treatment we will give is 3H. We will give 3H. The first H stands for humidified oxygen. We give humidified oxygen till the blood oxygen level, PO2 level, becomes more than 90%. Okay, we will also give hydrocortisone. What is hydrocortisone? It is a corticosteroid. And how it is given, this hydrocortisone? Hydrocortisone is given by injection IV because it is the fastest acting corticosteroid. Dose is 4 to 5 milligram per kg. Okay, and you will give high dose salbutamol. Okay, high dose salbutamol by inhalational route. Okay, so what was salbutamol? Short acting beta 2 agonist. So here we are giving high dose. Okay, okay. Now sir, if it is still not controlled, you will write add magnesium sulfate. Add magnesium sulfate by injection. Okay, if it is still not controlled, you will write add, not controlled, you will add inhaled ipratropium. Ipratropium is an anti-muscarinic. What was salbutamol? Short acting beta 2 agonist, SABA. Okay, it was a beta 2 agonist. Okay, so if it is not controlled, do these two things: add magnesium sulfate and ipratropium. Okay, now the point is, if the patient is having sudden worsening, if the patient is having sudden respiratory failure, okay, then you will add subcutaneous injection of 1-beta-2 agonist terbutaline. Subcutaneous injection of terbutaline. Remember, terbutaline is a beta-2 agonist, which is given by subcutaneous injection, or you can give intravenous injection of a beta-2 agonist, salmeterol. Salmeterol. Okay. Okay. If it is sudden worsening, but even if you will write, if it is not responding, if it is not responding to magnesium sulfate and ipratropium, then you will write intravenous aminophylline. Now, aminophylline is a congener of theophylline, which is a methylxanthine. It is also a bronchodilator. Okay, it is also a bronchodilator. So beta-2 agonist was a bronchodilator, antimuscarinic was a bronchodilator. We have added the third bronchodilator. Now, what is the dose of aminophylline? The dose of hydrocortisone was 4 to 5. The dose of aminophylline you will write will be 5 to 6 milligram per kg. Okay, 5 to 6 milligram per kg. Okay, sir, if it is still not controlled, not controlled, how you will assess? You are seeing the carbon dioxide level of the patient, and the carbon dioxide level of the patient in the blood is increasing. That means now the patient is not able to breathe, because the patient has now got tired. Because of this reason, the respiratory muscles are now not breathing. CO2 is accumulating in the body. So if the patient is not able to breathe now, put the patient on a machine which will make the patient breathe. Put the patient on general anesthesia. Make a patient unconscious by giving general anesthesia, and then put a tube and put the patient on a machine known as mechanical ventilation. Mechanical ventilation. Okay. So this machine will make the patient breathe now. Okay. Now, which general anesthetic agent would you like to use? The general anesthetic agent you will use is halothane, because this halothane is also a bronchodilator. Halothane is a general anesthetic agent which is also a bronchodilator. So this is the treatment of status asthmaticus. Okay, so when the patient will come, give humidified oxygen, not dry one, humidified. Okay, hydrocortisone 4 to 5, high dose salbutamol. Not controlled, add magnesium sulfate and ipratropium. Okay, if still not responding, add aminophylline. But if the patient is suddenly going into respiratory failure, give injection of beta-2 agonist, terbutaline and salmeterol. Not controlled, patient respiratory effort is now weaning now, not able to breathe, put the patient on general anesthesia with mechanical ventilation. So this is the treatment of status asthmaticus. This is overall the whole management of asthma, which you will learn in pharmacology, medicine and many other subjects. Okay, so this is the treatment or the management of asthma. Now let's discuss about anti-asthmatic drugs. Okay, let's discuss about anti-asthmatic drugs now. So let's see what are the anti-asthmatic drugs which we have already written. If you have seen, we have already written anti-asthmatic drug. You have already written in your notes bronchodilators and anti-inflammatory. So let's discuss about the properties of anti-asthmatic drugs now. So we will start with the word bronchodilator. We will start, the first drug we will start will be beta-2 agonist. Okay, so let's make a heading bronchodilator and make a heading beta-2 agonist in your notes. Okay, so let's make a heading. Let's discuss about now drugs for asthma. Drugs for asthma. So the first drug we will write is bronchodilators, and the first drug you will write is beta-2 agonist. Okay, beta-2 agonist. Okay, now what are the different beta-2 agonists? First we will see what is the mechanism of action. So beta-2 agonists, they will have direct effect on beta 2 receptor which are present on bronchial smooth muscle, which are present on bronchus. Okay, and remember these beta 2 receptors are of GS type of GPCR. We have discussed GPCR stands for G protein coupled receptor. They are which type of GPCR? GS type. When we activate this beta 2 receptor, when we stimulate this beta 2 receptor or GS type of receptor, remember they increase the level of cyclic AMP inside the bronchial smooth muscles. They increase the level of cyclic AMP, and this cyclic AMP causes bronchodilation. It causes bronchodilation. Okay, inside the cell. Okay, so this is their direct effect. So they have direct effect and they directly causes bronchodilation. But remember, beta 2 agonists have certain indirect effect also. They have certain indirect effect also, and they have certain effect. We will write that these beta 2 agonists, they have a property that they inhibit, minus means inhibit, mast cells also. They inhibit mast cell, they inhibit muscarinic receptors as well, little bit, not much, muscarinic receptors. Okay, remember they also inhibit mucosal edema. They also inhibit mucosal edema, which is a very bad thing which occurs in inflammation. Okay, and remember they promote, plus we will write promote, mucus clearance. Okay, they promote mucus clearance or mucus production, which is a very good thing in asthma. Okay, so these are the some additional effect of beta 2 agonists. Okay, so they causes increase in mucus production, and more mucus production will clear the respiratory pathway through ciliary movement. Okay, now let's see what are the drugs we have. So if we talk about the drugs among bronchodilators, we have certain non-specific beta 2 agonist, and we have certain selective beta 2 agonist. That means non-specific beta 2 agonists, apart from beta 2 receptor, they also act on other receptors. Other receptors. Let's see what other drugs we have. The first drug we have is epinephrine. Remember, epinephrine acts on alpha receptors as well as beta receptors, all sympathetic receptors. Okay, you can also write isoprenaline. It acts on beta 1, beta 2 and beta 3, all beta receptors. Okay, so you have ephedrine. It also acts on, just like epinephrine, on alpha and beta receptor. Now the point is that nowadays we don't prefer to use these drugs. Nowadays we prefer to use selective beta 2 agonists. Okay, so these drugs are not used, except this one drug, epinephrine. Remember, epinephrine is sometimes given as a subcutaneous injection, and epinephrine is a drug of choice for brittle asthma. It is known as brittle asthma. Okay, sir, what happens in brittle asthma? In brittle asthma, there is sudden death, sudden worsening of patient vitals, which may cause sudden death. Hence we give subcutaneous epinephrine. Why? Because it is the fastest acting drug we have. It is the overall fastest acting drug, but it is only used in a very rare type of asthma known as brittle asthma. Otherwise it is not used. So what is used mainly in the treatment of asthma? That is beta 2 agonist. So let's discuss about selective beta 2 agonist now. Now sir, so these selective beta 2 agonist, they are further divided according to their duration of action. Okay, so they are classified as short acting beta 2 agonist, which are also known as SABA SABA. Okay, then we have long acting beta 2 agonist, They are also known as LABA LABA. Okay. Now remember, sir, these long-acting beta 2 agonists, they are given twice. We will see how they are given. The third point you will write is, now we have a third class of a drug known as ultra LABA. That means ultra long-acting beta 2 agonist. Okay. Ultra long-acting beta 2 agonist. Now where they are used, remember, how do they produce effect? If you make a graph, sir, SABA, they produce the effect just like this. They produce instant effect. They cause instant effect. If they produce instant effect, they are the drug of choice for acute attack of asthma. That we have already discussed. Okay. Now, how LABA and ultra LABA produce effect? LABA and ultra LABA, they will produce effect just like this. Okay. They produce sustained bronchodilation. Sustained bronchodilation. My question is, if they are producing an effect just like this, can you use them for acute attack of asthma? Can you use LABA and ultra LABA for acute attack of asthma? The answer is no. Okay? They are not used for acute attack of asthma. They are used for, these two drugs, they are used for maintenance of asthma. Maintenance of bronchodilation in asthma, that we have already discussed. Okay. Now, what is the difference between LABA and ultra LABA, ultra long acting beta 2 agonist? LABA, they are given twice a day. They are given twice a day because they act for 12 hours. What about ultra LABA? Ultra LABA, they are given once a day. Why? Because they act for 24 hours. Okay, but both of these drugs, they are used for maintenance of asthma. For acute attack of asthma, we give SABA. Okay, because it produces instant effect. So let's see what are the drugs we have. Among SABA, you will write the name of those drugs. The first drug you will write is salbutamol. Another name of salbutamol is albuterol. Albuterol is another name of salbutamol. Okay. We have made levo form of salbutamol known as levosalbutamol, which is also known as levoalbuterol. Levoalbuterol. Okay. Then you will write other drugs like terbutaline. Next, you will write metoprotirenol, and lastly, you will write pirbuterol. Okay, pirbuterol. So these are the short-acting beta 2 agonists. And among, if a question comes, what is the shortest-acting beta 2 agonist? This is overall the shortest-acting beta 2 agonist, that is levosalbutamol. Levosalbutamol overall is the shortest acting beta 2 agonist. Okay, if this option is not given, then you will mark the answer salbutamol. So levo form of salbutamol is the shortest acting drug. Otherwise, salbutamol is the shortest acting drug. Let's discuss about LABA. The drugs among LABA we have, okay, in LABA they will have a word metoro. So you will write a word salmeterol. Okay, formeterol, R-formeterol, okay, just try to remember these three words, but you can otherwise also write a drug bambuterol. Okay, bambuterol. Remember, this bambuterol is a prodrug. Its active form is terbutaline. Its active form is terbutaline, but this bambuterol act for long duration of time. Okay, now if you talk about ultra long acting beta 2 agonist, ultra long acting beta 2 agonist, ultra LABA, you'll write the drug indactyrol. Indactyrol, olodaterol, olodaterol, vilanterol, clenbuterol. So these are the ultra long acting beta 2 agonists. Okay, so what is their route of administration, how they are given in the patient? Remember, all of these drugs are given by inhalational route, inhalational route, and all of these drugs can be given by oral route. All these drugs can be given by inhalational route as well as oral route. Okay, now we have a drug, terbutaline. This terbutaline is the only beta 2 agonist we have. It is the only beta 2 agonist we have which is given by subcutaneous injection. It is given by subcutaneous injection. It is the only beta 2 agonist we have which is given by subcutaneous injection. No other beta 2 agonist is given by subcutaneous injection. And where it is given, we have already discussed. It was given in status asthmaticus. Okay, and we have a drug which can be given IV, that is salmeterol. Salmeterol. Remember, terbutaline is not given IV. Terbutaline is given by subcutaneous injection. Okay, so this is the route of beta 2 agonist. Now next point is, you will write, these beta 2 agonists, they are racemic mixture. Okay, they are racemic mixture, and among this racemic mixture, remember, levoform, which is also known as R form, is the active form. Levo or the R form is the active form. That is why you are seeing we have made levosalbutamol, R formeterol, because levo or R form is the active form. Okay, now let's see what are the side effects of beta 2 agonist. So let's see the side effect. The first side effect you will write is tremors. The first side effect is tremors. You will write that this tremor is the most common side effect of beta 2 agonist, and it is dose dependent side effect. It is a dose dependent side effect. That means if you will increase the dose, more it will occur. Why it occurs? Because of stimulation of beta 2 receptors which are present on skeletal muscles. Remember, beta 2 receptors are also present on skeletal muscle, and when we stimulate them, it causes muscle contraction or tremors. Okay. Second side effect you will write is tachycardia, which is also known as palpitations. Why, sir? Because it is due to because it is due to stimulation of beta 2 receptors which are present on cardiac muscles. Okay, they are also present on cardiac muscles. Okay, the third point you will write is they show rapid tolerance. Rapid tolerance is also known as tachyphylaxis. What does it mean? It means rapid loss of effect. Why it occurs? It occurs due to rapid desensitization of beta 2 receptor that we have already discussed in general pharma, that they are G protein coupled receptor, and G protein coupled receptor, they become very rapidly desensitized. Fourth point, remember, they cause hypokalemia. They cause hypokalemia. Why? Because by stimulating beta 2 receptors on skeletal muscle, remember, the potassium which is present in the blood, it goes inside the skeletal muscle. The potassium which is present inside the cell, in the blood, it goes inside the skeletal muscle if we stimulate beta 2 receptor. Okay, this is their direct effect. Okay, then you will write they cause hyperglycemia. Why? Because of stimulation of beta 2 receptor on liver, they cause glycogen breakdown. Glycogen breakdown. And if glycogen will break down in the liver, remember, if glycogen will break down in the liver, this glycogen break down into glucose, and glucose will come out into the blood. Okay. And the last point is they sometimes causes hypoxia, a very transient hypoxia, due to, you will write, ventilation परफ्यूजन, मिसमैच, ओके, वेंटिलेशन परफ्यूजन मिसमैच, दैट इज वी क्यू मिसमैच. वेंटिलेशन इज वी क्यू, स्टैंड फॉर परफ्यूजन, बिकॉज इट इज ड्यू टू सडन ब्रोंकोडायलिटेशन. देर इज समटाइम्स वॉट हैपन्स, सडन ब्रोंकोडायलिटेशन, there are certain areas in the lungs where the oxygen supply is very poor, so if we dilate bronchus there, it will lead to hypoxia. Okay, so this is about beta 2 agonist. Now let's talk about the next class of drug. That next class of drug we have is anticholinergic or antimuscarinic agents. Antimuscarinic agents, okay, so antimuscarinic agents, they block M3 receptors which are present on bronchus. Okay, now what are the use of these drugs? Remember, these drugs are used as an add-on drug to beta 2 agonist for the treatment of asthma and the treatment of COPD. COPD stands for chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Okay, now how, what is the route of administration of all these drugs? So remember, all these drugs are only given by inhalational route, no other route is there, only by inhalational route. So what are the examples of all these drugs? You can write, the drug is ipratropium, bromide, BR stands for bromide, you'll write tiotropium bromide. Okay, you can write oxytropium, you can write umiclidinium, and a new drug just came some weeks before, that is eclidinium. Okay, now among them you will write that this ipratropium is the fastest acting drug and it is also the shortest acting drug. Hence, as it is the fastest acting drug, it was used in status asthmaticus that we have already discussed. Tiotropium, you will write, it is most M3 specific drug. So it does not act on any other receptor. Hence, it is considered now as a drug of choice for COPD. It is considered as a drug of choice for COPD. Okay, oxytropium is sometimes used in nocturnal asthma. It is sometimes used in nocturnal asthma, and this umiclidinium and eclidinium, they are very long acting drugs. They are long acting drug. They are used in chronic COPD if a patient has very frequent attacks. Okay, now what is the side effect? The side effect of these antimuscarinic drugs, you will write, they have atropine like effect, because atropine was also antimuscarinic agent. So remember, they decrease mucus production, which is a very bad thing, because mucus is protective for us. If you remember, I told you that beta 2 agonist, they increase mucus production. They increase mucus production, but M3 antagonist or anti-muscarinic agent, they decrease mucus production. Mucus is protective for us. Okay, they also cause midriasis. Because of midriasis, they can increase the risk of glaucoma, because glaucoma occurs due to midriasis. Okay, and they inhibit micturition. They inhibit micturition. Why? Because they cause bladder relaxation, hence the patient have a symptoms of urinary retention. Okay, so remember, these are the side effect of antimuscarinic agents. Okay, now let's move further. So next drug we will write is methylxanthines. Okay, methylxanthines. So methylxanthines, they are naturally occurring compounds. They are present in, remember, they are present in coffee, tea, and chocolates. They're present in coffee, tea and chocolates. Okay, so remember this part. Now in coffee, tea and chocolate you will find caffeine, theophylline and theobromine. In coffee you will find in maximum amount caffeine, but you also find theophylline and theobromine. In tea you find in maximum amount theophylline. In chocolate you will find in maximum amount theobromine, but they also contain other molecules. Okay, now remember that this caffeine, it has mainly CNS effect, and this theophylline, it act on bronchus, and this theophylline act in periphery. It is used in asthma. So in asthma we use theophylline. Caffeine is used in CNS disease. Okay, so remember, it is used, caffeine, it is used in certain headaches, for the treatment of certain headache. So it relieves headache, like it is used in the treatment of acute attack of migraine. It is used in the treatment of an headache known as migraine. It is also used for the treatment of a headache known as hypnic headache. Okay, so caffeine is used in some CNS. Okay, so in asthma we use theophylline. Okay, so let's make a heading, theophylline. So among these methylxanthines we use theophylline. Okay, theophyllines. Now let's see what is the mechanism of action of these theophyllines. How do they produce bronchodilation? You're right, their main mechanism of action is they are phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitors. Okay, they are phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitor, but remember they also inhibit phosphodiesterase 3 and 5. They also inhibit phosphodiesterase 3 and 5, but their main mechanism of action is they are phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitor. Remember, what is the function of phosphodiesterase enzyme? The function of phosphodiesterase enzyme is to degrade cyclic AMP. The function of phosphodiesterase enzyme is to degrade cyclic AMP. So if you will inhibit phosphodiesterase enzyme, can we say they will increase the level of cyclic AMP? Hence they will increase the level of cyclic AMP inside the bronchial smooth muscle, just like beta receptors. Okay, they increase the level of cyclic AMP. So this is their main mechanism of action, but apart from this they have certain other mechanism of action as well. Okay, so let's see what are the other mechanism of action. Remember, they are also adenosine receptor blocker. Okay, third point you will write, they also increase interleukin 10 release. And remember, interleukin 10 is an anti-inflammatory molecule. And you will write, they decrease interleukin 5 release. And interleukin 5, you will write, it is a pro-inflammatory molecule. It increases inflammation. In asthma, the major interleukin is interleukin 5, which promotes asthma. Okay. Now, fourth point you will write, they also inhibit calcium entry into muscle cells. Okay. They also inhibit calcium entry into muscle, and hence they produce, by all these effect, they produce bronchodilation. Now we have come to know that they have certain direct effect on DNA as well. On DNA you will write, they promote histone deacetylation. Okay, just write this one point, a new thing which we have come to know. But their main mechanism of action is phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitor. But they have many other mechanism of action as well. Because of this reason, as we are seeing, they are having many mechanism of action, but the main mechanism of action is phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitor. Because of this reason, we have made a new class of a drug, which is only and only phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitor. No other action. So these drugs are very new drugs in asthma. These drugs are only phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitor. You can write the name of these drugs like roflumilast, ibudilast, and selomilast. These drugs are only phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitor, and they have been recently approved for asthma. They have been recently approved for the treatment of asthma. Okay, but theophyllines, they have many mechanism of action. Okay, now let's see what are the drugs we have among theophyllines. Let's see what are the drugs we have. So remember, theophyllines, they are present in T. So remember, three drugs T. Okay, T. The first drug is theophylline. Second, you will write etophyllene. Third, you will write aminophyllene. Okay. Now remember, this theophyllene, when it is given orally, it is given as a sustained release oral tablet. Okay, sustained release oral tablet. Etophyllene is also given as a sustained release oral tablet, but it has better bioavailability. It has a better bioavailability. Aminophyllene is given by injection. And as we are giving by injection, we give the injection when a patient cannot take a drug orally. So it is given in an emergency known as status asthmaticus. Status asthmaticus. And at what dose we give aminophyllene? We give the dose 5 to 6 milligram per kg of loading dose. We give 5 to 6 milligram per kg of loading dose in the treatment of status asthmaticus, which we have already discussed. Okay. Now let's talk about their pharmacokinetics. Pharmacokinetic, that means how they are metabolized. Remember, these drugs, they are theophylline, they are metabolized by an enzyme CYP1A2. So this part you will refer in general pharma when we have discussed CYP1A2. Second point, you will write that these drugs are narrow therapeutic index drug. Okay, that means these drugs, they have a very low safety margin. That means if you will little bit increase the dose, they will produce toxicity. Okay, so what is the normal therapeutic range? That means, if you remember narrow therapeutic index drug, I told you that if you will keep on increasing the dose, the drug produces effect. By little bit more increasing the dose, the drug will produce toxic effect. So this therapeutic range where the drug produces beneficial effect is very narrow with them. Okay, and these drugs are known as narrow therapeutic index drug. And remember, if a drug is narrow therapeutic index drug, that drug requires monitoring. So these are the only anti-asthmatic drug which requires monitoring. If you are prescribing this drug in your patient, remember, you have to monitor their blood level. Okay, and this monitoring is known as therapeutic drug monitoring. So the only anti-asthmatic drug which requires monitoring is theophyllines. Okay, so when you are monitoring their concentration in the blood, what is their therapeutic range? You will write their therapeutic range is, their therapeutic range is, you will write 5 to 20 milligram per deciliter. Okay, if the blood level becomes more than, I'm really sorry, please write, yeah, please write please write micrograms. If the blood level becomes more than 20 microgram, remember they produce toxic effect. Okay, so these are the only anti-asthmatic drug that requires monitoring. Okay, so let's see what are their okay, so can we say that these drugs are very unsafe drug? Now the last point you will write that these theophylline, they show various drug interactions. They show various drug interactions. Okay, so you will write, if you will give any drug which is an enzyme inducer, that means the drug that will increase the activity of CYP1A2, can we say they will reduce the effect of theophylline? They will reduce the effect of theophylline. And if you will give some enzyme inhibitor, that means any drug that decreases the activity of CYP1A2, that will increase the level of theophylline, and increase in level of theophylline will produce toxicity. Okay, so remember, enzyme inducers, they reduce the effect of theophylline, and enzyme inhibitor, they produce toxicity of theophylline. So let's see, when we combine this theophylline with other drug, either they will show reduce effect or they will produce toxicity. So let's see what are the different examples of enzyme inducers and inhibitors. Okay, so in enzyme inducers, you can write a mnemonic GPRS. Okay, they will reduce the effect of theophylline. G stand for griseofulvin, which is an antifungal drug. P stands for phenytoin, it's an anti-epileptic drug. Rifampicin, an anti-tubercular drug. And smoking. So asthmatic people are generally smokers. Okay, enzyme inhibitor, you can write a mnemonic COCA, which can increase the toxicity of theophylline. You can write ciprofloxacin. Then you will write omeprazole, a proton pump inhibitor. Then you will write cimetidine. Then you will write allopurinol, an anti-gout medication, and one antibiotic, erythromycin. Okay, erythromycin. But you will write not azithromycin, because erythromycin inhibits CYP1A2, not azithromycin. Okay, not azithromycin. Okay, so these are the various drug interactions of theophylline. Various drug interactions of theophylline. Now let's see what are the side effects of theophylline. So among side effects, you will write the first side effect, their most common side effect is nausea, vomiting. This is their most common side effect. Okay, they also cause headache, and they also cause gastric discomfort. And all these side effect is due to inhibition of phosphodiesterase 4 enzyme. Because they inhibit phosphodiesterase 4 enzyme, these side effect also come. They also cause cardiac arrhythmias. They cause diuresis, frequent micturition. And in high dose, they also cause seizures. So they are very dangerous drug. And these side effect occurs due to adenosine receptor blockage. Because of adenosine receptor blockage. So these are the side effects of theophylline. You must remember. Now let's discuss about now other drugs. So now we will discuss about anti-inflammatory drugs. So we have completed with bronchodilators. Let's discuss about anti-inflammatory drugs. Okay, anti-inflammatory. So the first drug we will write is mast cell stabilizers. Okay, and remember, all these anti-inflammatory drugs, they are not bronchodilator. They are not bronchodilators. Okay, the first is mast cell stabilizers. So what they will do, what is their mechanism of action? So these drugs, they will go to the mast cell and they will tell this mast cell not to release the inflammatory mediators. They will tell mast cell not to release inflammatory mediators. Now, how do they tell mast cell not to release inflammatory mediators? Remember, on mast cell, there is a channel known as chloride channel. Okay? And this chloride channel is activated by a nerve known as C fibers. Okay? And this C fibers is activated by a molecule known as capsaicin. Capsaicin. When this capsaicin molecule comes to the C fiber, this C fiber tells the chloride channel, and through this chloride channel, this mast cell becomes activated and releases the inflammatory mediators. Now, what is the mechanism of action of mast cell stabilizers? You will write their mechanism of action is they inhibit capsaicin. They inhibit capsaicin induced C fiber activation, by which they inhibit activation of chloride channels. They inhibit activation of chloride channel. So they inhibit, remember three word, capsaicin, they inhibit C fiber, they inhibit chloride channel. Okay, capsaicin, C fibers and chloride channel. Hence, these mast cell will not release inflammatory mediators. Now, let's see what are the drugs we have. So, among mast cell stabilizers, the drugs we have are, you will write, the first drug which we made was chromoglycate. Okay, second you will write is nidocromil. These two drugs are given by inhalational route, and these two drugs are given in asthma, allergic asthma. Which asthma? You will write seasonal asthma. Okay, for prevention of seasonal asthma. We have already discussed for the prevention of exercise induced asthma. That we have already discussed among the management. Now we have one third drug as well. The drug is ketotifen. Okay, ketotifen. This ketotifen is given orally. This ketotifen is given orally, and it is mainly used in atopic dermatitis. It is also an allergic disease. Atopic dermatitis. You will write allergic conjunctivitis and allergic rhinitis. It is also used in allergic conjunctivitis and allergic rhinitis. What are the side effects of mast cell stabilizers? You will write they cause sedation and they cause dry mouth. The main side effect is sedation and dry mouth. So this is all about mast cell stabilizers. So mast cell stabilizer, they inhibit capsaicin induced C fibers, which inhibit chloride channel activation. The drugs are chromoglycate and nidocromil, which are inhalational, used in asthma. So they are used in prevention of seasonal asthma and exercise induced asthma. But I told you here the drug of choice was inhalational corticosteroid. Okay. And then we discussed the drug ketotifen. It's an oral drug. It is used in other allergic conditions. Okay. And the side effect is sedation and dry mouth. Let's talk about the next anti-inflammatory drug, that is leukotriene receptor blocker. So what is the mechanism of action of these drugs? Remember that these drugs, they block cis-LT1 receptor. They block cis-LT1 receptor. On this receptor, you know what acts? LTC4 and LTD4 act, and they produce bronchoconstriction. Okay, so they block this receptor, which is present on smooth muscles. Okay, let's see what are the drugs we have. Among them, the drugs we have, they end with the word leukast. So the drugs are montelukast, zafirlukast, pranlukast. Okay, and all these drugs are given orally. Okay, now where they are used? So these drugs we have already discussed, they are used in prophylaxis of or prevention of asthma. Okay, to reduce the dose requirement of LABA, long acting beta 2 agonist. Okay, because LABA, they are cardiotoxic drugs. Okay, so long term we don't want to maintain long acting beta 2 agonist. Okay, now what is their side effect? The side effect is, sir, there is a problem that majority of the people, they are non-responders. Some people, they don't respond to these drugs because leukotrienes are the not only, they are not the only, leukotrienes are not the only chemical mediator which is released by the mast cell. Other mediators are also released. Okay, non-responder. Now the second point is, their very important or characteristic side effect is, they cause Churg-Strauss syndrome. They cause Churg-Strauss syndrome. Now what is Churg-Strauss syndrome? You will write, Churg-Strauss syndrome stands for peripheral eosinophilia with vasculitis. With vasculitis, can we say they are increasing eosinophils level? The reason is, sir, if you have blocked this cis-LT1 receptor, the level of this leukotriene increases. The level of this leukotriene C4 and D4 increases because they are not able to act on their receptor. These leukotriene C4 and D4, remember, they recruit eosinophils. The level of eosinophils increases because these leukotriene are not able to act on this receptor. Their level in the body increases. Okay, hence they recruit eosinophil. If the eosinophil level becomes very high, this syndrome is known as Churg-Strauss syndrome, which may damage blood vessels and various organs. Okay, Churg-Strauss syndrome. Now the last class of drug finally we have is corticosteroids. Okay, corticosteroids. Now you will write, corticosteroid, they are the most effective anti-inflammatory drug we have. They are the most effective anti-inflammatory drug we have. Because of this reason, they are the drug of choice for prevention of asthma. They are the drug of choice for prevention of asthma. Okay, now the point is, so these drugs are not bronchodilator. They are not bronchodilators. Because of this reason, they are not used for acute attack of asthma. They are not used for acute attack of asthma because they are not bronchodilator. This is their major drawback. So they are the drug of choice for prevention of all type of asthma. Okay, but they are not bronchodilator. Okay, so can we say for acute attack of asthma, the drug of choice was short acting beta 2 agonist, and we also give LABA along with them, short acting beta 2 agonist. So the acute attack we give beta 2 agonist. Okay, but there is a point or a catch you must remember. Remember that these corticosteroids, they are not bronchodilator, but you will write, these corticosteroids, they improve the sensitivity, they improve the sensitivity or response of beta 2 agonist. That means they themselves are not bronchodilator, but they help beta 2 agonist to act properly. So beta 2 agonist will become more effective. They will become more effective when they are combined with corticosteroid. So corticosteroid, they themselves are not bronchodilator, but they increase the bronchodilating effect of beta 2 agonist. Okay, so let's see what are the drugs we have among corticosteroids. So among corticosteroid, we have three classes of drug. The first drug we have is inhalational corticosteroid. Inhalational corticosteroids, which is known as ICS, okay, which is generally considered as a drug of choice for prevention of asthma. Okay. Then remember, we have an oral corticosteroid as well. That oral corticosteroid was prednisolone. Okay, 30 to 40 milligram per day. And where it was used? When inhalational corticosteroid are not able to produce their maximum, in their maximum level, they were not produce their effect, they are not able to produce effect, then we give oral prednisolone, oral corticosteroid. So oral prednisolone is used in refractory asthma, which we have already discussed. So it is given in refractory asthma or resistant asthma. Then we have one IV corticosteroid as well, IV corticosteroid as well. That IV corticosteroid is hydrocortisone. The dose is 4 to 5 milligram per kg. And where it was used? It was used in status asthmaticus. So when you will give an injection, when the patient is going to die, in emergency status asthmaticus. Persistent asthmaticus, okay, which was also known as acute severe asthma. Okay, so these are the drug among oral prednisolone and hydrocortisone. Prednisolone in refractory asthma and hydrocortisone in status asthmaticus. Now let's talk about these inhalational corticosteroid or ICS. Okay, now when we give corticosteroid inhalationally, sir, what is the particle size? The particle size of any inhalational agent which is used in asthma is 2 to 5 micrometers or microns. The particle size of any drug which is given through inhalational route should be 2 to 5 micron. Okay. Now this size is, remember, it is known as MMAD. It is also known as MMAD. MMAD stands for, you will write, mass median aerodynamic diameter. Okay, so question comes that the particle size which we give through inhalational route, they should have a size of 2 to 5 micrometers. Okay, now let's see what is the dose, in which dose we give corticosteroid. Remember, among inhalational corticosteroid, our standard drug among inhalational corticosteroid, standard drug we have is, the drug is beclomethasone dipropionate. This is the standard drug which we use. Okay, now we compare the dose of all corticosteroid with beclomethasone dipropionate. Okay, we compare the dose with becla. So what is the dose of beclomethasone? You will write, which we have already discussed, that low dose was around, up to, it was around 100 to 500 microgram per day. Then we have high dose, that was 500 to 800 microgram per day. And what is the highest dose? Highest dose was 800 to 2000 microgram per day. Okay, this dose we have already discussed among step-up therapy. Okay, now by comparing with this betamethasone, let's see what are the other drugs we have. Other inhalational corticosteroid. So you will write, equally potent means the corticosteroid which will require same dose. The drug is, you will write, budesonide. सिक्लेसोनाइड. थर्ड यू विल राइट इज मोमिटाजोन. ओके, देन यू विल राइट मोस्ट पोटेंट. मोस्ट पोटेंट मीन्स इट विल रिक्वायर लोएस्ट डोज. ओके, अ ड्रग इज मोस्ट मोर पोटेंट इफ इट रिक्वायर्ड लेसर डोज. ओवरऑल द मोस्ट पोटेंट इनहेलेशनल कॉर्टिकोस्टेरॉइड यू विल राइट इज फ्लूटिकासोन. फ्लूटिकासोन. ओके, देन यू विल राइट लीस्ट पोटेंट इनहेलेशनल कॉर्टिकोस्टेरॉइड. लीस्ट पोटेंट यू विल राइट इज फ्लूनिसोलाइड. So least potent is flunisolide, most potent is fluticasone. Okay, you can also write triamcinolone. Triamcinolone. So overall the most potent is fluticasone. It requires lowest dose, and maximum dose which is given is of flunisolide. Okay, and the standard we use for the comparing is beclomethasone dipropionate. Now remember which glucocorticoids or corticosteroid that are not used, which are never used, not used as inhalational corticosteroid. Remember we never use betamethasone. We never use dexamethasone. Never use. Okay? So sometimes we get confused between beclomethasone and betamethasone. Remember in asthma we use beclomethasone, not betamethasone. Okay? Not betamethasone. Okay? Now let's see the side effect of these inhalational corticosteroids. Okay? Side effect of these inhalational corticosteroid. Okay, now the most common side effect of inhalational corticosteroid is dysphonia, which is also known as hoarseness of voice. This is their most common side effect because they cause vocal cord damage. They cause vocal cord damage. The second most common side effect you will write is oropharyngeal candidiasis. Okay, because when we give inhalational corticosteroid they reduce the immunity of the body and super infection, candida infection can occur. Remember this oropharyngeal candidiasis, it occurs in the dose high dose. When we give this inhalational corticosteroid in high dose, that means we give the dose more than 800 microgram per day, then it can lead to oropharyngeal candidiasis. Okay, now remember all inhalational glucocorticoid may cause oropharyngeal candidiasis except one. So all inhalational glucocorticoids they cause oropharyngeal candidiasis except cyclesonide. Except cyclesonide. Cyclesonide does not cause oropharyngeal candidiasis. The point is why? Because this cyclesonide is a soft steroid. It is a soft steroid. That means when we give this cyclesonide inhalationally, this cyclesonide itself is an inactive drug. It's an inactive drug. When it reaches to the lung, when it reaches to the lungs, it becomes activated by a specific enzyme which is present in the lung known as esterase enzyme. So inside the lung there is an enzyme known as esterases. Those esterases activate this cyclesonide and cyclesonide will produce its effect. But can we say that this cyclesonide, when it will get deposited in oropharyngeal area, it will not produce any effect and hence it will not lead to candidiasis. Okay, so sometimes we call cyclesonide as soft steroid. Okay, because it will not produce any side effect. Okay, now the point is, if other corticosteroids are producing oropharyngeal candidiasis, how we can prevent it? how you can prevent oropharyngeal candidiasis. You can write, do rinse the mouth with water after taking inhalational corticosteroid. So if a person takes inhalational corticosteroid, tell the patient to gargle his or her mouth with water and spit this water out. You'll write, use plastic spacers in mouth. Okay, use plastic spacers in mouth. Okay, and if this oropharyngeal candidiasis has occurred, remember the drug of choice for oral candidiasis is nystatin paint. Nystatin is an antifungal drug. Give nystatin paint. Okay, but if it has reached to the esophageal area, then give oral fluconazole. It is also an antifungal drug. Oral fluconazole, it is a drug of choice for fluconazole for esophageal candidiasis. Okay, if it is just to the area of oral area, apply an antifungal paint, nystatin paint. And if it has reached to the area of esophagus, then give an oral drug. Okay, now the last point is, so what is the advantage of using inhalational corticosteroid over oral corticosteroid? Why we prefer to give inhalational corticosteroid in asthma over oral corticosteroid? The reason you will write why we prefer to give inhalational corticosteroid, you'll write, they are safe in pregnancy. They are safe in pregnancy. You'll write, they do not cause ACTH suppression. Okay, they do not cause ACTH suppression and they do not cause Cushing syndrome. But what about Cushing syndrome? But what about oral corticosteroid? Sir, they are unsafe in pregnancy and they cause ACTH suppression and Cushing syndrome. But there is a catch out here. Remember, this inhalational corticosteroid may cause ACTH suppression or Cushing syndrome if their dose is more than 600 microgram per day. So below this dose they do not cause ACTH suppression or Cushing syndrome, but if the dose is more than 600 microgram per day, they may produce Cushing syndrome. Okay, so this is all about corticosteroid and this is everything about asthma. Okay, so thank you very much. Hello friends, now today we will be discussing about two topics, the drugs which are used for the treatment of cough and respiratory stimulants. Okay, so let's start with the first topic, drugs which are used for the treatment of cough. Okay, now let's see the list of the drugs which are used for the treatment of cough. The first class of a drug which are used for the treatment of cough, they are known as demulcents. Now what are demulcents? Remember, demulcents, they inhibit the efferent impulse which is coming to the lung. they inhibit this efferent impulse which is coming to the lung, and this efferent impulse generally irritate the lung, which causes cough. So demulcents, they inhibit efferent impulse coming to the lungs. Because of this reason, they provide a soothing effect. They soothen the airway. So they will have a very calming effect. What are the drugs which are used as demulcents? You will write, the drugs are Lozenges, Linctuses, and Glycerine. So these drugs, they have a calming effect on the airway, or they will soothen the airway. Okay, so it will decrease some efferent impulse or decrease the irritation produced by the efferent impulse. Now the second class of drug we have, which are used for the treatment of cough, they are known as expectorants. Okay, expectorants. Now remember, expectorants, they are given in the treatment of infective cough, or you will write productive cough. Okay, they are used in the treatment of infective or productive cough, because in infection there is a very high production of mucus. Because of high production of mucus, it is also known as productive cough. Okay, now expectorant are two type of drugs we have. The first class of drug among expectorant we have is mucokinetics. The second class of drug among expectorant we have is mucolytics. Now what do we mean by mucokinetic? Mucokinetic, they increase mucociliary clearance. It means it will help the body to remove this mucus out of the body. It will help this mucus to come out of the body as sputum. Okay, while mucolytics, they will liquefy the hyperviscous mucus. If the mucus has become very hard or hyperviscous, then they will liquefy this mucus. Okay, now let's say, what are the drugs? The drugs among mucokinetic, we will write, there is only one drug, that is guaifenesin. The drug name is guaifenesin. Okay, now the drug among mucolytics we have is, you will write, bromhexine. It is a prodrug. Its active form of bromhexine is ambroxol. The active form of bromhexine is ambroxol. So these drugs, they are given in infective or productive cough. Now we have certain mucolytics, they are used for the treatment of hyperviscous mucus, which is seen in cases of cystic fibrosis. In cystic fibrosis, the mucus become very hyperviscous or hard. To liquefy this mucus, we give mucolytic agent. These agents are very commonly used in cystic fibrosis, and you will write the names of these agents. You will write N-acetylcysteine. So they are also what? They are also mucolytic. N-acetylcysteine and other congeners of N-acetylcysteine, you will write, like methylcysteine. The third drug you will write is carbocysteine, and the fourth drug you will write is adocysteine. Okay, so they all are ending with the word cysteine, and so these drugs are given inhalationally in cases of cystic fibrosis. There is one more drug which is a mucolytic with a different name. You will write Dornase alpha. this DNase alpha, it will degrade. DNA strands which is present in this mucus, okay, DNA strands are because of the presence of the dead cells which are present in mucus in cases of cystic fibrosis, and these DNA strand makes the mucus hyperviscous. Okay, so these are the drugs among expectorant. Now the last class of drug among treatment of cough we have is antitussives. Okay, antitussives. Now remember, antitussives, they suppress cough centers. It will suppress cough directly. Cough centers directly. Now the point is, the person will not cough at all. Remember, these antitussives, they are only given in non-infective cough. Okay? They are only given in non-infective, which is also known as dry cough. Okay? So we suppress the cough only in cases of when it is not an infectious cause or a dry cough. Remember, they are contraindicated in infective cough. In infective cough, remember, or productive cough, remember, we never suppress the cough. Because through this cough, the infection is moving outside. We rather give expectorants, which we have already discussed. So remember, they are absolutely contraindicated in infective or productive cough. They are only given in non-infective coughs. Now, these drugs are of two types. Antitussive drugs are of two types, sir, which will act at a level of brain. So they will act at a level of brain and they will directly suppress cough centers in our brain. They will suppress cough centers in brain. Okay. Now second class of drug we have, through this brain, you know, the nerves come and these nerves, they go to the lungs. And these nerves, they cause cough. They induces cough. So there are certain drugs which will directly act at a level of lungs and they will inhibit the cough. So these drugs are known as peripherally acting. Peripheral acting cough suppressants. Okay? They are known as centrally acting cough suppressants. So they are centrally acting, they were directly suppressing the cough centers in our brain. They are acting in peripherally in the lung. Now among peripheral, we have only one drug. The name of that drug is prenoxdiazine. The only drug we have is prenoxdiazine, and it is an approved drug for non-infective dry cough. Among centrally acting, we have three class of drugs. Okay, so these drugs are divided into three class based on their chemical nature. Either they are opioids, non-opioids, and the third one we have is antihistaminics. Antihistaminics. Okay. Now remember, let's write the names of the drugs first. Among opioid, you will write a drug codeine. Codeine. And we have made certain congeners of codeine like folcodine, oxycodone. These are the modified version of codeine. Second drug you can write is morphine. And we have used certain modified forms of morphine also, like hydromorphone. They are known as hydromorphone. Now, what is the problem with these opioids? Remember, these opioids, they have a certain drawbacks. Remember, they are highly addictive. Hence, it can be abused. They have a lot of addiction potential. Second, they cause sedation. And they also cause constipation. These are the drawback of opioids. Now we have made non-opioids. Among non-opioid, we will write the first drug is dextromethorphan. Dextromethorphan. And the second drug you will write is noscapine. Okay. Now this dextromethorphan, what is their mechanism of action? It is an NMDA blocker. NMDA is a receptor of glutamate. It blocks glutamate or NMDA receptor. Noscapine, it stimulates sigma receptors in our brain. Okay, so they are not acting on any opioid receptor. What is the advantage of these drugs? Remember, these drugs, they do not have any addiction potential. These drugs, they are not sedative, and these drugs, they are do not cause constipation. So this is the advantage of these drugs, that these drugs, they do not cause addiction. No addiction is seen with dextromethorphan, no sedation and constipation. And finally, we have is antihistaminic drugs. Among antihistaminic, you can write that these drugs are mainly given for allergic cough. Allergic cough. So you can write the names of certain antihistaminic drug like promethazine, which comes with the brand name Phenargan, diphenhydramine, which comes with the brand name Benadryl, diphenhydramine. You can also give cetirizine. Okay. Now what is the side effect? The only side effect of these drugs are they are highly sedative. The only side effect of these drugs are highly sedative. They don't have addiction or constipating effect. Okay. While this dextromethorphan does not have any effect. Okay. Remember that part. So these are the various centrally acting antitussive agent. They suppress the cough centers in our brain. Okay. So these are the drugs which we use overall for the suppression of cough. Now the last part we have is respiratory stimulants. Respiratory stimulants. Now respiratory stimulants, remember, they are also known as analeptic agents. They are also known as analeptics. Now what is their function? Respiratory stimulants, they directly stimulate respiratory centers in our brain. They directly stimulate respiratory centers, hence they increase respiration. Now where they are used, let's see what are the drugs and where they are used. Let's see the names of the drug. You can write one mnemonic. The names of these drugs are DAFAN, Dafan B. The first drug is Doxapram. Second drug you will write is Almitrine. Then you will write Flumazenil. Then you will write Acetazolamide. N for Naloxone, and lastly Bimegride. Okay, now where these drugs are used, you will write, you at least this is expected from you, that you must remember the word Doxapram, Flumazenil, Acetazolamide, Naloxone. These are expected that you must remember their names. Now where this Doxapram and Almitrine are used, okay, Doxapram and Almitrine, they are approved for chronic hypoxia in COPD patients. Because of chronic hypoxia, the person is having less oxygen, which stimulate respiratory centers. Okay, these drugs are also approved for barbiturates and opioid poisoning.
Why barbiturate and opioid poisoning? Because in barbiturate and opioid poisoning, a person may die due to respiratory depression. The centers, the respiratory centers, they become depressed. Hence, we give respiratory stimulant or analeptics. But remember, they are not the drug of choice. The drug of choice for opioid poisoning is naloxone. The drug of choice for opioid poisoning is naloxone. It blocks opioid receptors directly. Okay? Flumazenil, you will write, it is the drug of choice for respiratory depression, which is seen in cases of mountain sickness. Mountain sickness. And lastly, acetazolamide is the drug of choice for mountain sickness. Acetazolamide, it is the drug of choice for respiratory depression, which is seen with mountain sickness. Okay. So respiratory depression. What about flumazenil? Flumazenil is the drug of choice for benzodiazepine poisoning. Because in benzodiazepine poisoning, again the patient dies due to respiratory depression. Okay? And this bimegride, last one, is considered as a drug of choice for barbiturate poisoning. It is considered as a drug of choice for barbiturate poisoning. Okay? So let's recapitulate again. We discussed these two drugs, amitriptyline and doxapram. They are very non-specific drug. Their first use is chronic hypoxia and COPD. Okay? And they are used in barbiturate and opioid poisoning. But they are not the drug of choice in barbiturate and opioid poisoning. In opioid poisoning, the drug of choice is naloxone. And in barbiturate poisoning, the drug of choice is bimegride. What about the other two drugs? Flumazenil, drug of choice for benzodiazepine, and acetazolamide, drug of choice for respiratory depression, which occurs in mountain sickness. Okay, so these are the examples of respiratory stimulants you must remember. So the mnemonic was Dafan B. Okay, Dafan Baro, or you can make any mnemonic you want. Okay, so these are respiratory stimulants. So thank you very much. Hello friends, now today we will be discussing about pulmonary artery hypertension. Now, what is the definition of pulmonary artery hypertension? The definition is when the pulmonary artery pressure, increases by more than 25 millimeter of mercury. This is the diagnosis of pulmonary artery hypertension. Okay, so it is when the pulmonary artery pressure increases by more than 25 millimeter of mercury. Now, what are the clinical features? We know that from the right heart, the blood flows to the pulmonary artery. And from pulmonary artery, it leaches to the lung. So if the pressure in the pulmonary artery will increase, this right heart will find very difficult to push this blood into the lungs. So the symptoms are, this blood will not go to the lungs, and from the lungs it will not go to the brain. So the person will feel fatigue because the left ventricular volume will decrease. Second, the symptom is dyspnea. Why? Because if a person will breathe, the oxygen will not be perfused into the lungs. And what is the cause of death? The cause of death is right heart failure.
The cause of death in these patients are right heart failure, which is also known as cor pulmonale. Okay, so these are the clinical features of pulmonary artery hypertension. So initially the person will suffer from fatigue and dyspnea, and the cause of death is right heart failure, because the heart has to pump more blood into the lungs and the pressure in the pulmonary artery is very high. Okay, now the second point is, what is the cause? Most causes of pulmonary artery hypertension are idiopathic. We don't know, but what it has been seen that it is associated with a disease known as systemic sclerosis. It is associated with a disease, systemic sclerosis. So most of the cause we don't know, but what is the pathology? Why there is increase in pulmonary artery pressure? So what is the pathology? The pathology lies between the imbalance. There is an imbalance between vasodilators and vasoconstrictors. Okay, so there are various chemicals which are produced by a blood vessel. So we know that if vasodilators are produced, vasodilators normally reduce pulmonary artery pressure, and vasoconstrictor will increase pulmonary artery pressure or pulmonary artery hypertension. So what happens in pulmonary artery hypertension? There is an imbalance between vasodilator and vasoconstrictor. The level of vasodilators decreases and the level of vasoconstrictor increases. Hence, the pressure in the pulmonary artery increases. Now, which vasodilators which are proven to be decreased in pulmonary artery hypertension? You will write, there is decrease in nitric oxide. Okay, and nitric oxide is a vasodilator. There is also decrease in prostaglandin I2 level, PGI2 level. PGI2 and nitric oxide, they are very powerful vasodilators. Okay, their level decreases. And what happens in vasoconstrictors? There is increase in level of endothelin. There is increase in level of endothelin, and endothelin is a very powerful vasoconstrictor. So this balance leads to increase in pulmonary artery pressure. Okay, now let's see, what is the management of pulmonary artery hypertension? Okay, management. If a patient of pulmonary artery hypertension comes to you and you have diagnosed that the pulmonary artery pressure is more than 25 millimeter of mercury, this is the diagnosis. Now, the first step is, in all cases, we will do lifestyle modification. We will do lifestyle modification. Now, what lifestyle modification? You will write, avoid pregnancy. Avoid exercise or physical exertion, and prevent or avoid infections. Okay, so these three modifications we have to do. Now, how do we decrease the pressure in this pulmonary artery? For the treatment, first we will classify this pulmonary artery hypertension. Okay, we classify this pulmonary artery hypertension into two types. We classify on the basis of vasoreactive testing. Okay, we classify pulmonary artery hypertension on the basis of vasoreactive testing. Now, what we will do in vasoreactive testing? In vasoreactive testing, we will give vasodilators. Now, which vasodilators we give? We give inhalational nitric oxide, or we can give inhalational prostaglandin I2. Okay, we give inhalational nitric oxide, we give inhalational PGI2, or we can give intravenous adenosine. These three substances are the vasodilators. If by giving these vasodilators, If the pulmonary artery pressure, PAP stands for, if the pulmonary artery pressure reduces by more than 10 millimeter of mercury, this form of pulmonary artery hypertension is known as vasoreactive positive. It is known as vasoreactive positive. That means when we give vasodilator, if the pressure reduces by more than 10 millimeter of mercury, pulmonary artery pressure reduces, then we call it as vasoreactive positive. If the pressure is not reduced by more than 10 millimeter of mercury by giving these vasodilators, it is known as vasoreactive negative. Vasoreactive negative. Okay, vasoreactive negative. Now, which is the more common form? Remember, vasoreactive negative is the most common form. Okay, now we will decide the drug according to vasoreactive positive or vasoreactive negative. Vasoreactive positive means that right now the endothelial cells of blood vessels are normal. Here the endothelial cells are abnormal. Okay, in vasoreactive testing, if they are not responding to nitric oxide and PGI2, we will say that endothelial cells are abnormal. If a person is vasoreactive positive, then the drug of choice for this pulmonary artery hypertension, which is vasoreactive positive, is calcium channel blockers. Is calcium channel blockers. Okay, now examples of these calcium channel blocker we can write as amlodipine, okay, nifedipine, diltiazam. So most of the time we use amlodipine. So if the patient is vasoreactive positive, then the drug of choice is calcium channel blocker. But remember, only less than 12% of the patients are vasoreactive positive. So it is a very rare cause. Vasoreactive positive, very rare patients are there. And if they are vasoreactive positive, we will give calcium channel blocker as a drug of choice. But we know that majority of the patients are vasoreactive negative. So we will give the drug, it will have a separate treatment. Now in vasoreactive negative, we will divide the patient on the basis of severity. We will divide the patient of vasoreactive negative on the basis of severity. This classification is given by WHO. Okay, now according to WHO, if a patient is vasoreactive negative, we classify the patient into four classes. That is class, you will write class 1, class 2, class 3 and class 4. As we are going from class 1 to 4, the severity of pulmonary artery hypertension is increasing. That means class 1 is mild form and class 4 is the most severe form. Now what we will be asking in the patient, we will be asking about the symptoms a patient is suffering. We know the symptoms are fatigue and dyspnea. So in class 1, remember, there are no symptoms of fatigue and dyspnea. In class 2, the patient has slight symptoms. In class 3, the patient has marked symptoms. While in class 4, the patient is bedridden. And in class 4, the patient has right heart failure. So in class 4, the patient suffers from already right heart failure. Okay. So we will be giving the drug according to the classes. If the patient is in class 1, no drug is required. no drug treatment is required. Okay, what about class 3 and 4? Remember, it is the most common form among all classes. This is the most common form. In class 4, 2 and 3, the drug of choice is, you will write endothelin receptor antagonist. Endothelin receptor antagonist. We know that endothelin causes vasoconstriction, and hence we will block the receptors of endothelin. In severe classes, we will give the drug prostaglandin I2 analogs. We know that prostaglandin is a vasodilator. We will give PGI2 from outside. Okay. So in most severe cases, the drug of choice is PGI2 analog. In 2 and 3 variety, the drug of choice is endothelin receptor blockers or antagonist. Now let's see further how to manage. If the symptom is not controlled by endothelin antagonist receptor antagonist, add phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors. So we will be discussing about these drugs. Add phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors. If still the symptoms are not controlled, add soluble guanyl cyclase activators. We will be discussing this drug. Just write the list right now. Okay, soluble guanyl cyclase activator. If still the symptoms are not controlled, then we add IPR agonist. If still the symptoms are not controlled, then we go to PGI2 analogs. Then we add PGI2 analogs. Okay, so this is the treatment of class 2 and 3. So finally, we have to give PGI2 analog. Okay, now if still the patient is having heart failure, if the patient is having right heart failure, to treat this right heart failure, because the patient may die due to this, we will do certain surgeries. We do atrial septostomy. What we will be doing in atrial septostomy, suppose this is the heart, we will create a septum between atria so that the blood from right heart will directly go to the left heart. It will bypass the lungs, because the right heart is not able to pump the lung into the blood into the lung. And the definitive treatment is lung transplant. Definitive treatment is lung transplant in severe cases. Okay, so in severe cases we will give PGI2, and if the patient is suffering from right heart failure, we will do certain surgery like atrial septostomy and lung transplant. So what are the drugs overall we have? The first drug we have is PGI2 analog. Let's write the word P. P stand for PGI2 analog. The second class of drug we have is endothelin receptor antagonist. Let's write E. Then we have phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors. Just write the word P. Okay. Then we have certain soluble guanyl cyclase activator. Write the word S. And finally, we have IPR agonist. Just write the word I. So this will make your mnemonic Pepsi. Okay, so these are the drugs. This is a mnemonic which you must remember. Okay, now before coming to individual drug, let's discuss certain points keeping on them, keeping what we have learned till now. Can we say that in pulmonary artery hypertension, first we will do lifestyle modification, and then we will classify this pulmonary artery hypertension into either vasoreactive positive or vasoreactive negative by giving these vasodilators, if they can decrease pressure or not. If it is vasoreactive positive, then we give calcium channel blocker. But these individuals are very small subset of patient. They are vasoreactive positive. Majority of the patients are vasoreactive negative. We will divide vasoreactive negative people into on the basis of severity. The patient is having no symptom, slide to marked symptom or the patient is bedridden. And in class 4, the patient has accompanied right heart failure. So we start the treatment from class 2 and 3. And we start the treatment in this way, Pepsi. Okay? Now, before going further, the first question arises. Which is the most effective drug for pulmonary artery hypertension? Can we say the most effective drug for pulmonary artery hypertension will be PGI2 analog, because they are used in severe cases? So the most effective drug for pulmonary artery hypertension is PGI2 analogs. Okay. The second question arises, most commonly used drug. Most commonly used drug for pulmonary artery hypertension. Can we say the most common variety was class 2 and 3? And the first drug we start is endothelin receptor antagonist. Hence, this becomes the most commonly used drug. Endothelin receptor antagonist. Now, the third question arises, which is the only drug in PAH which is also an antihypertensive drug? That is mean, that means which is also used in control of high blood pressure elsewhere in the body. Remember, calcium channel blockers, they are also antihypertensive drug. Okay, they are also used to control the normal, the increased blood pressure elsewhere in the body. So calcium channel blockers, they are additionally antihypertensive drugs. Okay, so these three points you must remember. So the most effective drug is PGI2 analog, most commonly used drug is endothelin receptor antagonist, and the antihypertensive drug, additionally antihypertensive drug, is calcium channel blocker. So if we choose one drug of choice for pulmonary artery hypertension, overall the drug of choice for pulmonary artery hypertension is PGI2 analog. Why? Because we choose the drug on the basis of efficacy. The most effective drug becomes the drug of choice. So generally, this is considered as the best drug or the mainstay of treatment. Okay? Now let's start with each of these drugs individually in a fashion Pepsi. The first drug we will be starting with, PGI2 analog. So let's make a heading, PGI2 analogs. Okay? Now remember one point, that PGI2 is prostaglandin I2. It is known as prostaglandin I2. Prostaglandin I2, they are also known as prostacyclins. They are also known as prostacyclins. Okay? This is their another name. Now, what is their mechanism of action? So, this PGI2 analogs, when we give, they act on PGI2 receptors. They act on PGI2 receptor. Remember, PGI2 receptor is also known as IPR. It is also known as IPR. IPR stands for I prostaglandin receptor. Okay? I prostaglandin receptors. Now, when they act on their receptor, remember, their receptor are of GS type. Okay, GS type of GPCR. GPCR, if you remember, G protein coupled receptor. And GS type of GPCR, they increase cyclic AMP level inside the cell. And this cyclic AMP produces vasodilatation. And as they produces vasodilatation, they decrease pulmonary artery pressure. They reduce pulmonary artery pressure. Okay, so they will directly act on their receptor. The receptor is known as PGI2 receptor, which is also known as IPR, I prostaglandin receptor, which is a GS type, that will increase cyclic AMP, that will reduce pulmonary artery pressure by producing vasodilatation. Second point, among all, they are the most effective drug we have. They are the most effective drug for pulmonary artery hypertension. Now let's see what are the drugs we have. For a drug, you can write one mnemonic, BITE. Okay? Among PGI2 analog, the drugs are BITE, BITE. Okay? So the drugs are BITE. तो वी विल राइट देयर नेम्स, यू विल राइट द फर्स्ट ड्रग बीरा प्रोस्ट. सो यू आर सीइंग दैट दे आर एंडिंग विद द वर्ड प्रोस्ट. प्रोस्ट मीन्स प्रोस्टाग्लैंडिन. सेकेंड इज इलोप्रोस्ट. थर्ड इज ट्री प्रोस्टेनिल. And lastly, we have is epoprostenol. Epoprostenol. Now, what is the route of administration? So, this biraprost was given orally. But this biraprost now has been banned. Why? Because we have seen that this biraprost does not produce any improvement. Okay. Then eloprost. Eloprost is given inhalationally. And it is an approved drug. It is not a banned drug. Okay. Triprostenil can be given by any route. You will write inhalational, oral. It can be given as a IV, intravenous, or subcutaneous. It can be given through all route. Inhalational, oral, intravenous, subcutaneous. And lastly, we have is epoprostenol. Epoprostenol is only given IV, intravenously. So these are the routes of administration, and these three drugs are approved drug. They are given in pulmonary artery hypertension. Biraprost got banned. Okay. Now, what is their side effect? So their main side effect is they produce hypotension. Okay, because of vasodilatation, they produce hypotension. Okay. Now, let's move further. Now, we have a similar drug. That drug is an IPR agonist. Now, if you remember, IPR is the receptor of prostaglandin I2. IPR is also known as prostaglandin I2 receptor agonist. This new drug is known as Selexipag. That new drug is known as Selexipag. How we can remember this name of Selexipag? If you are seeing, Selexipag is having the word IP. That means it is IP receptor. AG stand for agonist. So it is IP receptor agonist. So you can easily remember the name Selexipag. So it has same mechanism of action, just like prostaglandin I2 analog. It will directly go to the receptor. Okay, and you will write what is the route of administration. It is also given orally. So it's a new drug, Selexipag. It will directly go to the receptor and it will also produce same effect. Okay, now next class of drug we have is endothelin receptor antagonist. Okay. The next drug we have is endothelin receptor antagonist. Now, what is their mechanism? So, these drugs, they block endothelin. And we have already discussed that this endothelin was a very powerful vasoconstrictor. And if we block this vasoconstrictor, the pulmonary artery will dilate and the pressure will reduce. Okay? Because endothelin is a vasoconstrictor, you are blocking the action of endothelin. Now, let's see what are the drugs we have. Okay. Now, the drugs among endothelin antagonists are, you will write, bosentan, mesitentan, and lastly, ambrisentan. Now, how you can remember their name? As you are seeing, they are ending with the word ENTAN, entan. Entan means endothelin antagonist. ENTAN means, entan means endothelin antagonist. Now, what is the route of administration? Sir, all these drugs, they are given orally. And these drugs, they are the most commonly used drugs for pulmonary artery hypertension. They are the most commonly used drug for pulmonary artery hypertension. Now you will write that this bosentan, it blocks ETA plus ETB receptor. Remember, endothelin has two receptors, ETA receptor and ETB. Bosentan blocks both. Okay? Similar will happen with macitentan. It will also block ETA and ETB, both receptors. Okay? While ambrisentan, as the word A is coming, it will only block ETA receptor. It will only block ETA receptor. So it is selective for ETA receptor. Okay? So remember, bosentan and macitentan, they block both. Ambrisentan only blocks ETA. Now what is the side effect of these drugs? These drugs, endothelin receptor antagonists, they are highly hepatotoxic drug. They are highly hepatotoxic drug. And remember, these are the classes of drug which are absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. Why? Because they are teratogenic. So endothelin receptor antagonists, they are absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. Why? Because they are teratogenic. Okay? Now let's come to the third class of drug, that is phosphodiesterase inhibitors. You'll write PDE 5 inhibitors. Now what do we mean by PDE? PDE stands for phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors. Now let's see what is their mechanism of action. Sir, what happens normally inside the smooth muscles? Inside the cells of smooth muscle, there is a molecule known as GTP. Okay? This GTP gets converted into cyclic GMP by one enzyme known as guanyl cyclase. By an enzyme, guanyl cyclase. Now this cyclic GMP, remember, causes vasodilatation. It causes vasodilatation and it will reduce pulmonary artery pressure. Now what happens when this cyclic GMP produces its effect? It gets degraded. It gets degraded by an enzyme known as phosphodiesterase 5. It gets degraded by phosphodiesterase 5. Okay? Now, if you will inhibit this phosphodiesterase 5 enzyme, can we say it will increase the level of cyclic GMP? And if it will increase the level of cyclic GMP, it will produce vasodilatation and it will reduce pulmonary artery pressure. So phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors, what is their mechanism of action? They increase cyclic GMP level. And cyclic GMP produces vasodilatation, which will reduce the pulmonary artery pressure. Okay? Now let's see what are the drugs we have. Okay? Now the drugs which are phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor are, you will write sildenafil and tadalafil. Okay? Sildenafil and tadalafil. So these two drugs are approved for pulmonary artery hypertension. These two drugs are approved for pulmonary artery hypertension. But apart from this, we have other drugs as well. You will write vardenafil and avanafil. So they are ending with the word afil. Okay? And all these drugs are also approved for the treatment of impotency. All these drugs are also approved for the treatment of impotency, but in the treatment of pulmonary artery hypertension, only these two drugs are approved, sildenafil and tadalafil. Now what is their route of administration? So these drugs are given orally. These drugs are given orally. Now among them, you will write that this tadalafil is the longest acting. Okay? It requires only once a day administration. Once a day is known as OD. This sildenafil required TDS administration. TDS means thrice a day. So tadalafil require once a day administration. It is the longest acting. Now, what is their side effect? Sir, all these drugs, they cause flushing. Because of vasodilatation in skin, they cause hypotension. They cause hypotension, and due to sudden hypotension, it causes tachycardia. Okay? These are the side effects of these drugs. They cause flushing, hypotension, and tachycardia. But this sildenafil has one specific side effect. We know that sildenafil inhibit phosphodiesterase 5 enzyme. It inhibits phosphodiesterase 5, but remember, sildenafil also inhibit phosphodiesterase 6 also, and this phosphodiesterase 6 is present in eye. So when it inhibit phosphodiesterase 6 in eye, it causes some eye defect. It causes a side effect, you will write blue green color blindness in eye. It causes blue-green color blindness. It is a specific side effect of sildenafil. It also causes ischemic optic neuritis. It also causes ischemic optic neuritis due to sudden vasodilatation and reduction in blood supply to the retina. So these are the two specific side effects of sildenafil due to inhibition of phosphodiesterase 6 enzyme inside the eye. So it causes blue-green color blindness and ischemic optic neuritis. Okay, this sildenafil, it comes with a brand name known as Viagra. It comes with the brand name Viagra, and it is very commonly used, and it is considered as a drug of choice for impotency as well. It is considered as a drug of choice for impotency. Now, last point with this phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors are, so these phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors, they should never be combined with, nitrates. You should never combine these phosphodiesterase inhibitor with nitrates. The reason, let's see the understand. So these nitrates, these nitrates directly stimulate guanyl cyclase enzyme. If there is stimulation of guanyl cyclase enzyme, can we say they will increase the production of cyclic GMP? And cyclic GMP causes vasodilatation. Now, if you will combine these nitrate with phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor, we know that cyclic GMP is degraded by phosphodiesterase 5 enzyme. If you will inhibit phosphodiesterase 5 enzyme, it will also cause increases cyclic GMP. So when you will combine nitrate with phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor, there is a very large increase in cyclic GMP. It will cause massive vasodilatation. This massive vasodilatation will lead to massive hypotension. And this massive hypotension, the BP will fall very high, the patient will go to shock, and there will be sudden death. Okay? So remember, we never combine phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors like sildenafil, tadalafil with nitrates, because it will lead to massive vasodilatation, and which will lead to shock. Because nitrate, this stimulates guanyl cyclase, and phosphodiesterase inhibitor, they inhibit the degradation of cyclic GMP. Stimulation of guanyl cyclase increases the production. Inhibition of phosphodiesterase inhibit the degradation of cyclic GMP. Okay. Now the next drug we have is, we have SCG activator. Now what is SCG activator? SCG stand for soluble guanyl cyclase activator. Now, what is the name of this drug? The drug which is an approved drug is riociguat. The drug is riociguat. How you can remember riociguat? GU word is coming. GU stand for guanyl cyclase. एटी मीन्स एक्टिवेटर. तो रियोसीग्वाट इज अ ग्वानाइल साइक्लेस एक्टिवेटर. नाउ व्हाट इज द मैकेनिज्म ऑफ एक्शन, आई बिलीव यू मस्ट नो. ग्वानाइल साइक्लेस, इट इज स्टिमुलेटिंग ग्वानाइल साइक्लेस एंजाइम. डोंट यू थिंक इट विल इंक्रीज द फॉर्मेशन ऑफ साइक्लिक जीएमपी? ओके, इट विल इंक्रीज द फॉर्मेशन ऑफ साइक्लिक जीएमपी. ओके, सो सिमिलर मैकेनिज्म एंड द साइक्लिक जीएमपी विल कॉज वेजोडायलेटेशन एंड इट विल रिड्यूस पल्मोनरी आर्टरी प्रेशर. ओके, नाउ व्हाट इज द रूट ऑफ एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन, रियोसीग्वाट इज ऑल्सो गिवन ओरली एंड इट इज यूज एज एन एड ऑन ड्रग टू एंडोथेलिन रिसेप्टर एंटागनिस्ट विच वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस. नाउ रिमेंबर, नेवर कंबाइन रियोसीग्वाट विद नाइट्रेट्स एंड फॉस्फोडाइस्ट्रेस 5 इनहिबिटर्स लाइक सिल्डेनाफिल. द रीजन आई बिलीव यू नो, नेवर कंबाइन रियोसीग्वाट विद नाइट्रेट एंड फॉस्फोडाइस्ट्रेस 5 इनहिबिटर. द रीजन इज नाइट्रेट्स, दे कैन देमसेल्व्स स्टिमुलेट ग्वानाइल साइक्लेस एंड फॉस्फोडाइस्ट्रेस 5 इनहिबिटर, दे विल इनहिबिट द डीग्रेडेशन ऑफ साइक्लिक जीएमपी. सो बोथ दीज ड्रग्स, दे देमसेल्व इंक्रीजेस साइक्लिक जीएमपी, इट विल लीड टू मैसिव वेजोडायलिटेशन एंड शॉक. ओके, इट विल लीड टू मैसिव वेजोडायलिटेशन एंड शॉक. ओके, सो दिस इज द लास्ट ड्रग. नाउ देयर इज अ न्यू ड्रग विच इज अंडर क्लिनिकल ट्रायल, वेरी सून इट विल गेट अप्रूव्ड. द नेम ऑफ दैट न्यू ड्रग यू मस्ट राइट इज, विच इज राइट नाउ नॉट अप्रूव्ड बट वेरी सून इट विल गेट अप्रूव्ड फॉर पल्मोनरी आर्टरी हाइपरटेंशन, दैट न्यू ड्रग इज इमेटिनिब. A new drug which can be approved very soon is imatinib. Now what is imatinib? Imatinib, remember, it inhibit PDGF. PDGF stands for platelet derived growth factor. Now sir, this platelet derived growth factor causes blood vessel hypertrophy or thickening. Suppose this is a pulmonary artery, it causes thickening of pulmonary artery. If there is thickening of pulmonary artery due to growth of cells, it will lead to increase in pulmonary artery pressure. Hence we inhibit platelet derived growth factor. So it's a very promising drug which will very soon get approved. Okay, right now it is not approved. Okay, so this is all about pulmonary artery hypertension. Thank you very much.